Board, this is the meeting of the Health Committee for February 29th, 2012. And the first order of business, in addition to the order that are on the agenda, will be the question of the confirmation of James C. Cox as the Medicaid Inspector General for the state of New York. Mr. Cox has been duly nominated by the Governor Andrew Cuomo to be Medicaid Inspector General. He has submitted his information and has an impressive background, especially with the federal government in regard to the Office of Inspector General there. I would like to call Mr. Cox to make a presentation to the committee and perhaps respond to questions if any of the Senate members have any. And I just want to say it's a very auspicious day, given the fact that February 29th is leap year.
We can do this every 4 years.
Yeah.
Thank you, Senator. Chairman Hannan and other members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today. I am James Cox. I am the Medicaid Inspector General. As you know, the mission of the Office of the Medicaid Inspector General is to enhance integrity of the New York State Medicaid program by preventing and detecting fraudulent, abusive, and wasteful practices within the Medicaid program and recovering improperly expended Medicaid funds while promoting high-quality patient care. Medicaid program is a health care program for millions of New Yorkers funded by taxpayers. The vast majority of the health care providers within the program work every day to ensure that vital services are delivered. Our work is focused on fighting fraud, improving integrity, and saving taxpayers' dollars. In order to accomplish our mission, we have worked very hard in the last few months to improve our procedures. This work included hosting an OMAG working group, which has helped us better focus our efforts and also transition our organization into business line teams, affectionately known as BLT. The working group has also led to a number of other process improvements we will be implementing. We are confident that the business line team approach will lead to better results. Again, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
I just take the prerogative as chair to ask the first question, but it's a fairly broad one. Last year, the both houses of the legislature passed the legislation that would attempt to address some of the process and procedures of the Medicaid Inspector General. And I know that the governor vetoed it last year and set up a working group that you've been chairing. And I wonder if you would give us your thoughts as to the direction you're taking as a result of that working group and the veto.
Sure, absolutely, Senator. As you mentioned, the governor directed me to establish an OMAG working group to address
the concerns. Can you speak up just a little bit?
Sure.
Even with hearing aids, it's hard.
Okay.
Maybe you need to respect your support.
As you know, the governor directed me to establish a working group to look at the concerns that were identified in the Senator Little and Godfrey bill. As such, we established a working group late fall. It consisted of about 35 to 40 individuals represented from various associations and provider groups and consumer representatives, as well as some of the regulatory agencies. We had representatives from the Health Department, OMH, OPW, OASIS as well. So far, we've had three meetings. The first meeting consisted of me just listening to the concerns that the provider community had and the issues that were outlined in the bill. To be honest with you, I listened intently. I agreed with a lot of the concerns that they had. I thought that as a new person to the agency, that there was definitely some room for improvement in our operations. After the first meeting, we met internally and devised a plan to somewhat address the concerns that were mentioned to us in the first meeting. And we put together a list of improvements that we could make, and we discussed it in the working group as to what do you think about if we were to implement these changes, would that be consistent with, to address your concerns? And the third meeting, which we just concluded last week, was kind of a culmination of that process where we specifically, through a PowerPoint presentation, listed out the concerns and the specific recommendations that we would be making to address those concerns. And I think that the meetings went extremely well. It was well received by the rider community. We had a lot of input. We had a lot of discussions back and forth. I see some members in the room today of our working group, and it went very well. And I think some of the changes that we're talking about making helped align our processes, but mostly it deals with coordinating our efforts and our approach and making sure that what we do is the right thing. Again, focus on identifying fraudulent practices, and we are aligned with the regulatory agencies, what their interpretation of the criteria. That was one of the big issues in the bill, was the inconsistencies that the provider community was receiving from different state agencies. So we're working extremely closely with the regulatory agencies to make sure that we understand what the intent was behind the rule and regulation. So that's one of the big areas that we're addressing. And I think, Senator, that by establishing this business line team where we go into by categories of service, where we have what I call a holistic approach, a multidisciplinary approach, where we have auditors, investigators, counsel's office involved right up front, we have clinicians involved right up front, as well as folks from the regulatory agencies. So we're internally coordinating our efforts so that there's not a duplication of what we're doing, as well as coordinating with the regulatory agencies, again, to make sure that we have a thorough understanding of what the rules and regulations ought to be. And then, and again, not overlapping with some of the work that they were doing.
Take some questions.
Sure.
Good morning, welcome.
Morning.
You know, I've been here 32 years, and every time we have a change of administration, we get a new leader, and the new leader says, I appoint so-and-so, and he's going to do so-and-so, and so-and-so, and so-and-so. Mm-hmm. And before I leave here, I find that my big concern is, I don't know if you ever saw the last fall, late in the fall, there was a CBS 60 Minutes about the fraud and how deep it was across our nation. Very, very enticing program. Within the next week, I had 50 phone calls. I know that they're getting two wheelchairs when they only need one in this area. Nobody was there to talk to me. I mean, I'm very proud and thankful for what you've done to grab people together so they know one another and what's going to be expected of them. But I'm looking to see some positive results out of not just you, but those that you're entrusted with to supervise, because this is not going to stop with Medicaid. It's no matter what you do. And for example, the gentleman in Atlanta, who they had flashed his face, he said, close me up today and I'll open up in 30 days down the street. What are we going to do with something like that? I ask you.
Thank you, Senator.
And
be honest with you, that's a great observation. It's wonderful. It's an observation that we have seen at the federal government. I think, as you are aware, I have 23 years experience with the federal government. Prior to that, I was a local law enforcement officer, so I have some experience there as well. And the allegations of fraud are substantial in all over the country, as well as here in New York. We are working, again, closely with this holistic approach where we're getting together in these business line teams where we are actually meeting and conversing and making sure that we are targeting the right individuals using the knowledge and the tools that we have, data mining tools, for example, experience. We have people on the street. We have shoppers on the street. We have some tremendous investigations that are going on a day-to-day basis to make an impact. We have something that's going to be coming out very shortly relative to some prescription drugs, which is another area that certainly is needed focused attention. And when we set up our business line teams, we looked around at the work we're currently doing and what we intend to do. And I asked the question, why are we doing this work? Is it something that we need to do? What's the return on investment? Not just in terms of dollars, but in terms of making an impact. And so we're focusing our work and looking at the areas that we should be looking at, as well as doing the data mining behind the scenes, getting those folks involved. We're working collaboratively with a lot of different agencies. I'm a firm believer in certain things. One, transparency. Again, I can't be transparent when it comes to investigations, but I will let you know that I believe in transparency. But I also believe in working collaboratively. We've established some great relationships with the Department, the Bureau of Narcotics Enforcement, specifically when it comes to drug conversion. We're working closely with the Medicaid Fraud Control Unit. We're working with the district attorney's offices. We're working with county employees that are out there. There are certain counties that employ their own auditors. We're working, I've made a point of going around to the different counties and meeting with those individuals, because I also believe that the people in the field know where the problems are. Me sitting up in my office and 800 North Pearl doesn't necessarily give me hands-on information that, I believe that our folks have.
One quick one.
Yes.
2 weeks ago, I went to a veterans employment at West Point, and there was a young gentleman there, West Point graduate, 26 years old, lost his arm in Iraq, and he was forming a company that he'd already started years ago. They were doing investigations across the nation for various states on Medicaid fraud. I don't know if he's ever contacted you or not, but from what we found out, that they've had some success. And are we in any way, shape, or form looking at outside assistance to help us? Because sometimes you live in the house so long you don't know where the bathroom is.
It's an analogy.
he's a Russell Sage graduate, right?
Yes, I am.
I have a daughter in class of 78.
The again, point well taken. We are utilizing a multidisciplinary approach. We have private contractors that are working for us. We have contractors that that are working with the various counties. Again, we're using this multidisciplinary approach where we're making the biggest
impact. Thank you very much.
Senator Golden. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good meeting with you today, Mr. Cox, and I'm very impressed that what I'm hearing this is. I always lead off, and Senator Hannon knows how I lead off, that it usually starts with $54 billion in Medicaid, and if New York City, and specifically counties that I come from, Kings County, being the capital of the nation when it comes to fraud, I'm happy to hear that we are working, of course, with all the different agencies and the different prosecutors. The question that I think Senator Walker forgot to ask about was the wheelchairs, was the price of the wheelchairs. I think that's what you're best at. They're $40,000 a wheelchair, the price of a BMW today. This durable equipment and the fraud that's going on in our communities is outrageous. Are we doing any the prosecutors that you're working with? Is the incentives there for them to want and for your office to be able to give them incentives from the recoveries of fraud? And how are they working with you?
They're working very well. I wish more counties would be involved in our what we call county demonstration program. There are currently 12 counties that are participating. This process that we have, this demonstration program, allows the state to pay for and reimburse the counties the expenses that they have to that they incur in their audits and investigations.
And that's recoveries. So they get a percentage of the recovery?
Yes, sir. They get half of the, after we take back the what we gave them for the reimbursement, we share 50-50.
Thank you. The audits that you're doing, there was a tendency to in-house a number of those audits. Is the tendency, if you as well, your office under this governor, to do increased number of audits and to outsource these audits?
Again, we're utilizing a cooperative approach and utilizing when need be outside contractors. You make a large portion of our recoveries and help us with cost savings. So it is in-house. We do a lot of work, and we're also working with the counties and their contractors.
And I go out for a bid, I presume. You let the chairman know and myself, the requests that are going out, request for proposals for new woods, so that we can see who and where and what's going out and what's being done in your agency.
Certainly.
And last question. The fraud recoveries, are we increasing on the fraud recoveries? Are there more money coming in at the state level and at the county level as a result of your investigations and as leadership of your office?
I can tell you, looking at the trends over the last several years, that our total cost avoidances and recoveries has been increasing.
Well, all we needed here was 21st century technology with 21st century investigators to be able to come up with a 21st century solution to fraud here in the city of New York, and hopefully we're going to get there. And thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Senator Cousins?
Yes. Thank you, and thank you for being here. And again, your resume is extremely impressive. I just wanted to follow up on the statement that you just made about only 12 counties participating in the program, and you wish that more would participate. Obviously, that is an abysmal rate. I don't know who the counties are, but what do you think is the major deterrent why more counties are not involved? Out of 62 to have 12, what do you think is?
I think that we as an agency can do a better job of promoting this demonstration project. That's one of the approaches and changes that we are making is more educational in nature and going out and letting folks know that this opportunity does exist. So I think that we can do some of that. There's also some hesitancy to just have it be the state's problem, but I don't buy that, to be honest with you, because of the local district participation.
All right, so to the extent I think that any of us can be helpful in terms of helping our counties to become familiar, I think it would be a good idea to share that information with us.
Yes, and you know, I'd be more than willing to participate in any kind of educational events that you might want to sponsor, or anyone might want to sponsor.
Senator Young.
Well, just to follow up on what Senator Golden said and Senator Stewart Cousins, I'm very interested in this demonstration project and how it actually works. Is that included on your website, or where can you find out more information about it?
Yes, it's on our website. But, would you like to set up a separate meeting?
I would love to set up a separate meeting because in some of my counties, we have exploding Medicaid costs, particularly in Chautauqua County. Mm-hmm. And I think that we need to do a more in-depth analysis of what actually is happening there, because certainly the taxpayers are suffering as a result of it. So I just want to say congratulations to you. Look forward to working closely with you, and it's great that you're here today.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Senator Montgomery.
Yes, just to you, Cox, welcome, and thank you very much for what you've already begun to do in terms of outreach. And as you know, one of the areas of concern that you've begun to address it is smaller people who sort of caught in the middle and often are not educated to the new rules and regulations. And so it's helpful that you have an open door policy already. Appreciate the performance and continuous.
Thank you very much.
Any other questions?
Yes.
Senator Seward?
Thank you, Chairman. And just back stuff. I've been encouraged in listening to your comments in terms of the emphasis on better coordination of the efforts at all levels in terms of fighting fraud. I have a sort of general question in terms of you know, the savings numbers. Each year when we do the budget, there's a targeted number that we're counting on in terms of savings from reduced fraud, fraudulent claims, and of course recoveries. This isn't a trick question, but I guess I would ask that year is an adequate target or a doable target, and that the numbers going forward through your increased efforts be even larger in terms of potential savings for the taxpayers of the state?
Good question, Senator. We have been closely monitoring throughout this fiscal year how are we measuring up to that particular target. I will tell you that as of the numbers come in from January, it looks like we will meet our target this year, $1.1 billion. So that's significant cost savings and cost avoidances. Looking at it going ahead next year, our target is slightly increased. And I believe that we are in a position, the governor has placed us in a position in terms of funding for agency, and our internal changes, I think that we'll absolutely meet that target again next year. But I do think it's a very reasonable target.
Any other questions? Before we do that, the fact that you've been acting Medicaid Inspector General gives you some insight into the office, but I think that I would like to ask if you could go back to the committee as we get towards the end of the legislative session, if we could go over some of the provisions that were in the bill. I didn't necessarily agree with all of those, but I know they had raised concerns, and I'm also concerned about moving forward with your target. Because frankly, it was myself and Senator Skelos who wrote the Medicaid Inspector General legislation and helped get it passed. So we're concerned with having a balance and know that with your target being slightly increased, there's going to be lots of discussions. But we want to do what we can to advance the purpose of creating your office. So if you might at some point with a convenient schedule, I would like to do that.
Absolutely. I'd love to come back here and chat with folks. Just, I don't want to keep folks too long, but you mentioned this word balance. Balance is very important to me as well. You know, I believe that there's a large number of providers out in the community that want to do the right thing, and in fact are doing the right thing, but it's our job also to identify those providers that either are intentionally committing fraud or just need to move it over and down in different directions. But I would love to sit down in the future over our
clients,
make sure
we're on track. Thank you very much. I would like to, I think the tradition is in the finance committee, they ask the nominee to leave, but I don't get a sense that we have a problem here. So I'll put the question as to whether or not the nomination of James C. Cox as the Medicaid Inspector General shall be confirmed by the Health Committee. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Against? You're confirmed. Now, senators, we still have an agenda. The first bill that I will call is Senator Fischillo's bill, S-594. Authorizing any prosecutor of a competent jurisdiction to receive referrals from the Office of Medicaid Inspector General.
Move it. Have any questions?
Questions by Senator
Durham. It's actually interesting we're discussing it today, actually, just because I'm Inspector General, asked to provide this on the committee. But I just wanted to ask, since Senator Shows out here, maybe you can answer. What would be the exact need to expand authority to local prosecutors when the Office of the Inspector General, as well as the Attorney General, have authority and have investigation?
Well, the OIG does not judge investigations. When it finds evidence of actual fraud, it makes the referral to the FUCO, the Medicaid unit of the Attorney General. If it's made resulting so much of a workload that the Attorney General can do because of the statewide nature of the jurisdiction, I believe Senator Fischella feels that he could have better enforcement, increased enforcement, if the DAs around the state could take referrals also.
I'll be voting negative on this, particularly because I think that the expertise is in the Attorney General's office in this particular in this particular part of the Attorney General's office, having local prosecutors who might not have expertise.
Well, I would just argue that fraud is fraud, and our attorneys, district attorneys deal with fraud every day. In fact, the Manhattan district attorney is renowned throughout the nation for dealing with very sophisticated fraud cases. Ready to move to the question? All in favor?
Aye.
There's two negatives, Senator Gennaris and Senator Rivera.
I'll vote no.
Without Rex, Senator Mundell. The next bill is Senator LaValle, agreements for access to death certificates through the Department of Health. Discussion?
Move it.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
The negatives, the bill is before you.
Okay, without Rex.
Without Rex, Senator Rivera. Next bill is Senator DeFrancisco's bill, creating the Governor's Council on Physical Fitness, Boards of Health. Discussion on it. All in favor?
Aye.
Against? It's reported. 3672. Changes of reference to private duty nursing services from private duty nursing services to specialized nursing services. These are cases where the severely disabled are treated at home. The private duty has given the erroneous impression to some people that this is some type of serious treatment that ought not to be in Medicaid, where in reality, this is a very difficult service to some of the most needy and avoid their having to be permanently institutionalized. So it's trying to just change the type of thing. All in favor?
Aye.
Against? Resignation ability reported. Senator Lisi, this is a regulation of cadmium in children's jewelry. It has been reported by us last year.
Move it.
Discussion? Those in favor, Senator Larkin.
Second.
Second, Senator Young. All in favor?
Aye.
Against? It's reported. Five 114, Senator Savino, creating an outreach and education program for the disease known as lupus.
Move it.
Second.
It was moved. Second. Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Against? Bill is reported. 6029, Senator Lanza, requires the Department of Health to assign at least one narcotics investigator to each county in a city having a population of 1 million or more.
Move it.
I have a couple questions, Senator.
I don't understand. And Senator Lanza is obviously not here, but what would be the need to assign an investigator from the Department of Health? It seems that if we're talking about narcotics,
the bill says the Bureau of Narcotic Enforcement, which is the regulatory agency for looking into controlled substance misuse and diversion in the state.
So it would add, I'm just concerned about $500,000 of extra cost here. And it says that it would cost about maximum $455,000 annually. And what would be the exact purpose of these investigators? If there's police departments that investigate narcotics, and there's a unit at the state level that already performs some of these investigations, what is the meaning of having an extra investigator in each?
It is the Bureau is dealing with especially the huge upsurge in the misuse of opioid drugs in the last decade in the state. The extent is somewhat overwhelming. We just issued a white paper last week, which I would heartily suggest to you once you read to understand why Senator Lanza has this concern. Statistic from that paper is, takes the number of scripts that were written, prescriptions that were written in 2010, last year that we have statistics for, notes that 22 million prescriptions for painkillers were written in 2010 without refills. I mean, that's more than we have residents in this state. And the both actual statistics as to diversion and the anecdotal stories about diversion, misuse, criminalities, et cetera, are legend. And especially the Senator Lanza feels that there has not been enough investigation of this problem in Staten Island and would like the attention to be directed. It doesn't require stationing, it just requires a sign to. And he feels that that would resolve that problem. Further questions? Discussion?
Move the bill.
Senator Larkin has moved the bill.
Second.
Second. Senator Seward? All in favor?
Without rec.
Without rec. Rec. Senator Stuart Cousins, without rec. Senator Rivera, and you without rec. Also, Senator. The bill is reported. I agree. Questions of which go to finance and all that are over the agenda. Senator Gallivan, requiring notice of notification that physician information that's on the Department of Health website may not be all-inclusive or up-to-date. Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Against? Bill is reported. Next bill is Senator Ball's bill, which would speed up the temporary approval of applications to operate a women's, infants, children nutritional program.
Move it.
Move it. Discussion?
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Against? Bill reported. The next bill is 6493, providing improvements and reductions in medical assistance payments for home care services shall not be subject to interest and should be payable monthly.
Move it.
Discussion? Motion, motion is to move it. Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Bill is reported. And the last bill is a bill to require hospitals who have treating newborns to offer the parents, persons in parental relationship, and caregivers a vaccination for whooping cough, otherwise known as pertussis.
Move it.
This is what we've done for flu, and it's just the offer up so that they can, they know that this pretty devastating condition can be treated. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Bill is reported. Thank you.